Well, I can think of about 10 reasons off the top of my head. My Little Pony is a franchise that's known for having lots of characters, and especially in its earlier years, where the franchise as a whole was more about the successful toys rather than any tie-in supplementary material, like the show, storybooks, or comics. It's also worth noting that usually Pony goes for a group of lead characters, see My Little Pony Tales' 7 main girls, or Friendship is Magic's main 6. Even G5 has 5 main characters of interest to follow. But the important part about all these eras having a main cast is that there are many, many secondary characters present. Secondary characters that interact with our mains to tell interesting stories or have interesting dynamics. Misty, for example, God bless her soul, is an extremely interesting character given her situation. This makes her interactions with the main 5 interesting because this character, due to events that happen in her life, Opaline is a bitch, has a completely different mindset and understanding from our titular heroes. Another example is how in Ponytales, most of the main characters have families. This does more to flesh out each character just that little bit by seeing their home life. This also goes a long way for fleshing out the world itself. So we've established that character interaction and character differences are necessary for interesting dynamics and storytelling. And that brings us to the topic of today's video, Core 7. First of all, what is a Core 7, Partly Pinky? In Generation 3, nearing the end of its run in 2008, Hasbro decided to reboot the entire franchise. Why? Beats me. G3 had just started to find itself some sort of consistency, then the Big H tore the rug right out from under them. Now all of a sudden, no Wisteria, no Spike, no Rarity, no Breezies, and worst of all, no Minty. What Core 7 did was aim to focus on a friend group of ponies who were to be the stars of the franchise from then onward. Now that I totally get, but it's the execution that screws it over. In doing so, they axed the thing that made My Little Pony's fantasy world so bright and colorful, its characters. Without the characters, there's hardly a world to speak of. We'll talk about why Core 7 failed miserably at a story perspective, a collector's perspective, and a business perspective. Let's start with story, since the collecting and business side of things kind of go hand in hand. So if it's just gonna be these 7 ponies for the rest of G3's run, they better be some damn good characters, especially if they're taking place of classics like Minty and Thistle Whistle. So let's meet our 7. Pinkie Pie, a classic from the G3 specials. How could you not expect her to return? She's bubbly, she's cute, and she's pink. Pinkie Pie basically represents G3 as a whole. Apparently though, a lot of people disliked her for that very reason back in the day. I don't know, I don't mind. Every franchise has to have its logo character, and Pinkie works out well in that department. Something Core 7 does is kind of push her into a leader role, which I think works nicely. Pinkie was always shown to be smart, and did plan the world's biggest tea party, along with the Here Comes Christmas candy cane ceremony in Minty Christmas. All in all, Pinkie is a good inclusion. Rainbow Dash. Well, this is a pretty instant departure. If you know anything about G3, it's Rainbow Dash, and her catchphrase of
"Darling,"
that cements her diva-like personality and voice into anybody's head, be that through repetition or real impact. Rainbow Dash's attitude has been dumbed down. She's still one for fashion and beauty, but without her original voice from actress Venus Terzo, she feels like a completely different character. She's now voiced by Anna Kummer, who does a good voice for this new take on the character, but simply dashing just isn't as iconic as Darling. Rainbow's elegance and maturity in her voice is what made her distinct from the other ponies, and without that, she kind of just blends in, which is a trait that plagues most of the Core 7, as you'll see. Tularula. It's worth noting that this incarnation of the character is new to this era. Before Core 7, Tula was a warm magenta pony, with aquamarine and purple shades in her hair. Tularula's occupation is my and many others' favorite thing about her. She's an artist. Unfortunately, that's kind of it, but I do like that we have an arts and crafts pony. Cheerilee. Well, the second version of her, anyways. Yeah, pre-Core 7, Cheerilee was a unicorn that taught Rarity how to be responsible. She had a problem with blaming herself for Rarity's actions, which directly contrasted Rarity's problem of blaming everyone but herself. Cheerilee is also shown to be thoughtful and caring, showcased well in Comeback Lily Lightly. Now forget everything I just told you. For Core 7, Cheerilee became an Earth Pony, except she didn't. This is Cherry Blossom, a pony that, to my knowledge, hadn't appeared in the specials. Hasbro took Cherry Blossom and renamed her Cheerilee. Why they decided to rename Cherry Blossom to a character that already existed is beyond me. But this is Cheerilee. She's a hairstylist. This is rarely brought up. She's also a storyteller. The most interesting thing about her is actually that she's the big sister of the next character we're going to talk about. Have you started to notice that I have more to say about the history behind these characters than their Core 7 incarnations? Scootaloo, the little sister of Cheerilee. Originally, she was released as a Scoot Along pony back in 2005, which is actually carried over into her character. Scootaloo is the rowdy little sister who likes to play outside and is super athletic. This makes Scootaloo the most unique pony out of the group. She's a scrunkly. Look at her. Scootaloo contrasts the others well with her scrappy nature, so this alone makes her fun to pair with other characters. Sweetie Belle, the only unicorn of the group, bakes sugary snacks for everyone. She's the youngest of the bunch, and canonically the last member to join the group. Despite this, she has a normal-sized horn. I can't think of anything else to say about this character. Starsong deserved better! The only Pegasus of the group, and because of this, she's quite shy, which is not only adorable, but also in character, as Pegasi and G3 are inherently shy. Sometimes her wings beat like a bug rather than flap like a regular Pegasus. Not sure why that is, but it's cute. Starsong is a singer, and while her dream is to sing on stage, her flighty nature, pun intended, can get in the way of that. She has both a cute personality and a dream, which conflicts that personality. I want to remind everyone that I know it's G3, so I'm not expecting some amazing character writing, but ponies like Minty exist, who has charm, memorable moments, a conflict, and individuality under all that copy-pasted mane. This is what makes G3's characters so lovable. They're simple, but they make that simplicity theirs. You'll know who Minty is. You'll remember Thistle Whistle and her whole deal. There is some major mileage you can get out of writing a creative character like Starsong well. However, 2008's special was a 30-minute cartoon called Meet the Ponies. This is the nail in the coffin. The Core 7 might not be that different from each other, besides their occupations and the little details. But that's all just character synopsis. The real character moment should shine through in the media. Well, Meet the Ponies doesn't serve to tell you anything new about these characters. It only tells you what you already know. Instead of being one continuous story like previous releases, Meet the Ponies is structured into 7 chapters, one short for each pony. In each one, the pony of choice throws a party for all the others in the friend group. Each episode showcases the very bare-bones traits of each pony, and they make sure they go into each one. For example, Minty is known for liking green and wearing socks, but she's also clumsy, kind-hearted, and gets very worried when she wrongs her friends by accident. This is seen in many different points across the specials. Scootaloo likes butterflies and to play outside, and that's about it. That's all I learned about her when watching Meet the Ponies. Because each episode is the same, let's have a party, plot, with the exception of one. The characters are only defined by what they like, and not what they are like themselves. And you might think I'm being a little harsh for ragging on this 130-minute special for it, but don't worry, that's pretty much what all Core 7 media is. Pinkie Pie's Party and Party Parade, released for the DS and PC respectively, both have the same flaws. These characters don't get into mischief or have fun dynamics, they just kind of exist next to each other. What's made even worse is that these are the only characters, these 7 right here, and it just gives Ponyville this desolate wasteland vibe. It doesn't feel real. Other ponies will show up, but not a single one has a speaking role. It really feels like a betrayal to the characters we got to know and love in the original specials, because these characters don't have any fun dynamics, or do anything. It's a far cry from the discovery of Pegasi, or making sure the rainbow celebration happens on time. It's hard to get attached to this friend group when they don't really act like a group of friends, especially considering they're what replaced a lot of fan favorites. But, as I've stated before, videos, games, books, they're all supplementary material compared to the real moneymaker, the toys. Good lord. To put it simply, you could only buy these 7 ponies. Only. Throughout 2008 to early 2010, you weren't seeing a single other pony on the shelves. All those colorful brushables, gone. Here's Core 7. Don't worry, you'll get some extremely basic variants later down the line. Ponyville? Yep, those figurines were affected too. Brand identity? Now you're just going to see Pinkie all over the place. Other toys? You name it. Books, radio, specials, food, party supplies. Hasbro was basically forcing us to enjoy these 7 ponies or none at all. Can you imagine what that must have been like? This happened for 2.5 years. Yes, I'm sure it saved Hasbro money to literally reuse the same pose over and over, but did it really make them any money in return? Let's find out. Well, I reached out to one of my friends who was a collector during the Core 7 rebrand. He said that a lot of people actually stopped buying ponies just because Core 7 took so much of the fun out of it. Some people even sold their collections. I can't blame them. How can someone collect something when they already have all that there is to offer? G3 ponies used to have fun gimmicks, like Lily's light-up horn, or Starflight and Heartbright's existence. They'd come in fun playsets, sometimes themed around the pony itself. They'd have releases that actually changed up the toy. Core 7 is just the same boring horse over and over again. This is the real problem with it. I can deal with similar characters that don't add a lot, but the toy market doesn't need to have the same philosophy. One time, there was a special Minty released, and according to him, it flew off the shelves instantly. Not just because this pony looks really cool, check out that gradient though, but because this thing was finally something different. He also sent me this forum post, which I'll link in the description, that really gives you a good idea of what collectors thought during the time. The claims are definitely backed up when you see just how bleh people feel about Core 7 ponies. I'd even go as far to say as it failed with its target audience too. This is purely based on speculation and unorganized field testing, but I always see people say they're nostalgic for Minty Christmas or Princess Parmenon. After a very pony place, fans seem to get almost as obscure as the other residents in Ponyville. Little kids aren't dumb, like most people think. I'd assume they know if they were only finding the same ponies over and over again. But perhaps I'm wrong. If you genuinely enjoyed collecting Core 7 ponies and amassing a huge army of Tularulas, more power to you. I'd love to hear from someone who genuinely likes this era. In fact, I believe there are a couple of good things about it that often go overlooked. Okay, we have to talk about G3.5's most amazing change to this franchise. Different hairstyles. Oh shoot, did I talk about G3.5? Well, in any case, this is the brief period at the end of G3 where the toys change styles to be, essentially, chibi versions of the characters. The most important cornerstone of 3.5 is Twinkle Wish Adventure, its movie. I do want to make a whole video on this movie in the future, so right now let's just focus on the Core 7. So, as I was saying before, the hairstyles. They do amazing work to give everyone just that little bit of variety. Tula's is so unique, Rainbow's is stylized just how I'd expect hers, and Cheerily, well, most of you should know I love ponies with ponytails more than most things. I understand not a lot of people like this art style, and it's totally understandable. Personally, I think it's pretty cute. It feels like G3 transitioning into G4, which kept the hairstyle thing, so hell yeah. But it's not just visually. Firstly, this movie feels like it actually has a plot, unlike Meet the Ponies. A very simple one, that's kind of just Minty Christmas with extra steps, but hey, that's better than nothing, especially during this era. So they actually utilize these characters a little bit. Cheerily and Scootaloo being sisters actually mean something. They have a very natural back and forth sisterly vibe. They fight, despite one being more mature than the other. Cheerily in particular gives off similar vibes to her original incarnation, albeit less wise. She's also quite book smart. Don't get me wrong, this Cheerily is certainly different, but she gives an aura of responsibility that's directly opposed by her sister. Scoot is extremely scrappy. They really play into her little sister vibe here. She's even smaller than the rest now, and sees situations in a very straightforward manner, much like a kid her age would. She's also quite the troublemaker, making her even more different from Cheerily. Scootaloo is also helped by her friendship with Sweetie Belle, who's now the youngest of the group. Because they're both little, they hang out together more than anyone else, and I really like what they do with Sweetie. She's the comedic relief character now, always saying a funny quip or bit, and it works so well because she's the youngest. Her innocence is what makes these lines deliver so comedically. And look at that! I was just able to talk about three different characters by discussing how they affect one another. Unfortunately, the last four aren't as connected. Pinkie Pie is still a leader, Rainbow Dash likes shopping, Star Song is the cutest thing in the universe, and Tula actually gets changed a bit. In this special, we learn she's afraid of the dark. Aww. Oh yeah, and her friends actually help her out with this. Oh right, they actually do something this special. Because Scootaloo fucked up, the gang... That's what I wrote? Because Scootaloo fucked up, the gang travel via balloon all the way up to Willy Nilly Mountain, where the weather changes willy nilly. There they meet a dragon named Whimsy Weatherby, who's the best character in the film, by the way. Actually, yeah, that's new. Characters that aren't the Core 7. Also introduced is a mare character who gives them the MacGuffin that starts this whole thing. And Ponyville itself is populated again. There are actual background ponies, some of which get lines. You don't know how starved people were. Genuinely, 3.5 does so much for Core 7. Having the characters be actually unique from each other, giving them something to do, and making them interact more like friends do. It's a shame that this movie is so slept on just because of the art style. It's actually quite funny. It's bad luck not to practice what you preach, so I'd like to show you how I'd make my main cast of MLP, limited to the cast of Core 7. All these ponies were done using G4 bases I found, because I was too lazy to draw myself, so I'll credit all the sources in the description. We're going to be taking a lot of credit from Twinkle Wish's adaptation of these characters, with my own spin on things. Pinkie Pie, the quick squinking leader of the group. Pinkie Pie knows a lot about a lot of things, and always puts her friends first. Pinkie is never negative, but she does have a slight sarcastic side. She's an optimist, but she's also a realist. Because of Pinkie's happy yet grounded nature, she makes a good leader figure and motivator for the rest of the group. Pinkie Pie will always help you if you're in a jam, and give it her all when it comes down to it. Pinkie Pie's right-hoofed mare is Minty, the sweetest yet clumsiest pony around. These two get along very well, even if Minty's hijinks can end them up in trouble. Of the seven, she's most close to Rainbow Dash, as the two share a love for colors, and were the first to be friends. Pinky also shares a close bond with Tularula, as they both appreciate the simple things in life. One friend that actually gets quite on Pinky's nerves is Scootaloo. They have a little brains versus brawn thing going on, with Pinky's planning and observation usually going over Scootaloo's smooth brain, which is really just a hamster doing kickflips on a wheel. So the two tend to bicker, but do enjoy each other's company in the end. When the going gets tough, they have each other's back. Scootaloo herself is one for athleticism. She is the type to act first and think later. Skating tricks and cool action poses are this mare's forte. And while on the outside, she may just seem like nothing more than an outlandish mischief maker, Scootaloo is extremely loyal to her friends, most of all her big sister Cheerilee. If you mess with any of the other six ponies, be prepared to face Scootaloo's wrath. Cheerilee tries her best to keep Scootaloo out of trouble, but that doesn't stop the pony from forgetting to wipe her hooves in the doormat sometimes. Someone who super motivates Scoots to be as curricular as she is Sunny Days, another very athletic and flexible pony. Sunny inspires Scoots, who wants to be just like her in terms of gymnastic capability. You'd think these rambunctious actions would particularly offend the always prestigious Rainbow Dash, but the fashionista actually acquires a sporty taste from the orange pony's athletics. And of course, she gets to model stylish, protective gear for her, which sponsors her main clothing line. Star Song's flighty side is mainly brought out around Scootaloo, as she's never able to expect when the titular horse will scoot her way out in her bombastic manner. Of course, Cheerilee and Scootaloo behave around each other just like they do in Twinkle Witch Adventure. I don't see any reason to change that. Scootaloo also likes to help Tularula, specifically with her abstract work, which is just wild and carefree enough for her to enjoy. Tularula prefers her own artwork, however. She's the quietest of the bunch. Of course she loves her friends, however the studious artist is quite mysterious in her ways. It's hard to look at Tula and know exactly what she's thinking, mostly because her head is always full of ideas for art projects. Tula has been an artist blessed with amazing creativity ever since she was young. She needs her alone time to work on her paintings, but looks to her friends for inspiration and reviews. She's also quite down to earth, always speaking what's on her mind, even if it's a little blunt. But she's very gentle and always means well. Pinky and Tula get along very well because of this, able to understand each other's outlooks. Star Song feels very safe around Tula due to her quiet nature, like a bird perching by a quaint river. Star and Tula also understand each other's values in music and art respectively, both being creative outlets that take lots of effort and soul. Tularula likes horror movies, she enjoys experimental art forms, and can tell a surprisingly good campfire story. The only thing that's ever been shown to spook Tula back is actually Sweetie Belle. Just look at her. Demon child. Tula and Rainbow Dash also have a good connection, with Rainbow always coming to Tula to get help on which colors complement her newest design. Rainbow Dash loves her job, making wonderful clothes for all of Ponyville. Whether it be dresses, pants, hair bows, or even hats, this darling Dash has got it covered. We're going more with her original personality and playing a bit more into her pompous side. Rainbow Dash takes her profession seriously, especially against her competitor, Sue and So, who also makes clothes. They have a sort of friendly rivalry going on that never gets too serious. Rainbow usually doesn't let her ego get the better of her, but sometimes it can slip her mind that there's always a pony underneath the razzle dazzle. She always gives her friends a nice discount on her dresses. This glamour girl may be a business pony, but she also likes to have fun. And friendly races and board games bring out the competition in her just as much as Sue and So lowering her prices. Rainbow Dash and Cheerilee are gossip buddies, but more so just because Cheerilee is a good listener, while Rainbow Dash is a great talker. The two also enjoy shopping together. The dressmaker also sponsors Star Song. The two of them have a partnership going on. Rainbow makes the most glamorous dresses that fit Star Song's newest label, and Star wears them while performing. The two are great friends and always advertise each other. Dash is surprisingly a good caretaker, and if anything, it's almost like that cool aunt that you probably have, specifically to Sweetie Belle, who she definitely spoils a bit. Sweetie Belle is still the smallest, because that added variety makes her memorable. She's a unicorn, but not just any unicorn. We're going to make Sweetie Belle into Rarity's up-and-coming underling. Sweetie looks up to Rarity almost like a big sister, especially in her ways of fun. This is also a natural step for Rarity, as she's already learned how to balance being responsible and having fun. Now she has to teach someone else that same principle. Sweetie is an amazing baker. When it comes to cookies or muffins, she can even make plain old bread taste sweet. If her tiny stature and squeaky voice isn't enough to cue you in that she's the baby of the group, her innocence and carefree yet comical attitude is. Often she gets wrapped up in Scootaloo's plans, such as getting the cookie jar off the refrigerator. Whereas Scootaloo is usually caught for her actions, Sweetie often gets away scot-free. She's impressionable, so if the whole group is down for something, you know Sweetie will be too. She enjoys a good round of dress-up with Rainbow Dash, who else? And actually, putting her in charge for a change is a baking mentor for Pinkie Pie. Pinkie Pie isn't really the best when it comes to food. If there's one pony who's a tad overprotective of her, it's Cheerily, who understands Sweetie's age and status and is always concerned on if she should be following the rest in their adventures. Cheerily is actually going to be a mix of both of her incarnations. Unicorn mentor and intelligent storyteller slash history expert? Yes. Hairstyler? Nah. That's never really brought up, so we're going to move that occupation over to Rainbow Dash. Much like pre-Core 7 Cheerily, this Cheerily is mature and collected, until something bad happens. Then, she constantly blames herself. Thanks to her friends, she's able to see that whatever is wrong can be remedied with the power of friendship. Cheerily can be a bit of a worrier, but when all is well, she's a very smart cookie. She knows all about the world from the various stories she reads. Obviously, she's very loving and protective of her little sister, Scootaloo. The two do bicker, but always make up in the end. If it's ever really a bad argument, as sisters do have them, Tularula steps in to act as a mediator, thanks to her focused mind. Cheerily is always wanting everyone to feel welcome. She can easily tell when someone's upset, and likes to listen to other ponies' stories, which she can really get into sometimes. Cheerily can be a bit emotional thanks to her love of reading. This can lead to her comparing life's events to that of a storybook. She always wants the best for her friends, particularly Sweetie Belle, who she almost treats as another younger sister. Cheerily also gets along very well with Pinky and Tula. The three of them are most common to agree on something. Cheerily and Rainbow Dash are quite contrasting in terms of attitude, with Dash's bombastic voice and ideas. Cheerily sometimes helps her bring her head out of the clouds if she's ever too into something for her own good, keeping her in check. Cheerily also listens to Star Song's singles before they're released, helping her write lyrics sometimes using her vast lexicon she's learned from reading. Star Song has big dreams. Born on Butterfly Island, she dreams of singing on a stage like a shooting star shining stupendously all over Ponyville, Unicornia, Breezy Blossom, and beyond. There's only one issue. This Pegasus is shy. Star Song is a very nice mare, who always wants the best for her friends, but she sometimes doubts herself of her capabilities. A loud noise could make her jump upwards almost like a cat. But when Star Song steps on stage, and she faces the crowd, all her fears are stripped away as she sings out loud with as much emotion and passion as she can. Star Song puts a lot of love into writing her songs, which are mostly rock or swing, but sometimes she mixes it up a little with a slow emotional piece. Not only does she write the music, but she sings solo too, unless of course it's a group song with her friends. Pinkie Pie is actually the one who helped Star break out from her shyness to perform her first song on stage. Pretty quickly after that, Ponky vowed that she and her friends would help Star Song reach the top no matter what. Star Song is extremely grateful because of this, but sometimes she feels like she doesn't fit in. The group will always reassure her that it's because they're all friends, and she's more than just a pop star to them. There's only one Star Song. Rainbow Dash makes clothes specifically fitting her performances, and Scootaloo, even if her sudden movements can sometimes scare her, always makes sure she cheers the loudest at her concerts. Tularula provides Star Song someone to talk to about her passion for music, as does Cheerily, of course, and all the girls are sure to motivate her with a big cheer before she even goes on stage, even though they know the moment her hoof touches the mic, she's gonna rock it. Another pony who really motivates Star Song is Starcatcher, the leader of the Pegasi, whose majestic appearance and magical gaze is what taught Star Song that there is beauty in music in the first place. At the end of every day, Star assures herself of accomplishing her goals and being friends with the best ponies she's ever met. So, that's all seven, but I'm not done. Come on, you knew this was coming. Minty is Pinkie Pie's closest friend, and of course Pinkie jumped at the chance to introduce her to all the new ones she's met along the way. She already knew Rainbow Dash, who always makes sure Minty's clothes are extra green. Minty's not allowed inside Tularula's house after one too many paint bucket spills, but the two definitely have something in common. Painting socks. Tula's vibe clashes with Minty, but they're still good friends. Scootaloo sometimes gets silly Minty to do her chores for her, to which Cheerily always apologizes afterwards. But of course, the happy-go-lucky green pony never minds it one bit. Sweetie Belle and Minty make some interesting tasting sweets together, and Minty actually makes a great percussionist for Star Song's more hyper songs. Pinkie Pie and Minty think the world of each other, and both agree that life would be boring without one another in arms. Pinkie is always there for Minty to push her in the right direction, and Minty is always there for Pinkie to help her bounce back. Minty is silly, zany, clumsy, but always puts her heart forward first. Name it, she has tripped over it, spilled it, or bumped into it. But if anybody is going to cheer a pony up, whether it be through words or actions, you can bet it'll be Minty. And there's nowhere she'd rather be than with all her friends in Ponyville. That's another thing about Minty. She knows everyone and everything, and vice versa. Minty gets around and always has an idea of who to call if there's trouble. Yes, Minty can make a problem, but she can also do all she can to solve one. Well, that's my Core 7, or 8, I guess. Seriously, Minty deserved to be in there from her legacy alone. Just look how much better the cast looks with a splash of green. But that's just how I do things. I'm obviously not claiming these characters are perfect. I've just expanded upon them a tad. A little substance never hurt anybody. But now I'm super interested. I'd love to know your interpretations of the Core 7 and its characters. Please let me know in the comments, or by going to the Butterfly Island Resort Discord server, link in the description. Wrapping this up, I want to briefly talk about what happened after Twinkle Wish Adventure. No, not that! Generation 4 was an entire rebrand that seemed to give Pony a lot of substance that it was missing. I still have bountiful amounts of respect for its first few seasons, but Core 7 walked so the main six could run. Of the group, six of its seven members returned in some way, shape, or form. Pinkie became the comedic relief, Rainbow Dash turned into an athlete, Cheerilee became a schoolteacher, Sweetie Belle and Scootaloo still hung out, and Toolaroola showed up in an episode later on. With the unfortunate exception of Star Song, the poor girl never got her time in the spotlight. Well, sorta. She does appear in the comics as a unicorn, for some reason, but I still feel pretty betrayed that she never appeared in the show. Common Hasbro L. So that's pretty much all I have to say about Core 7. What a weird and misutilized era of the franchise, especially in the toy department. It just goes to show how hard G4 bounced the franchise back into place. Core 7 came out at an all-time low for Pony in general. Most franchises wouldn't be able to recover from a stump like that. Well, what do you guys think? Oh wait, I already asked you to comment something. Comment on my videos, I want to see what you think. Anyways, this has been Partly Pinky, and what am I gonna do with 13 Pinkie Pies?